So, our next speaker is Paul Topolos. The title of this talk is A Film Artist's Journey Through Innovation. Paul is a matte artist, concept designer, and storyboard artist at Pixar Studios, and he has worked on nearly every feature film from Finding Nemo to current movies like Inside Out. Please give a big, big welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. You didn't have to, but you did. I like that in an audience. When I was asked to speak about unreasonable thinking, I got a little nervous because I've been trying to be reasonable all my life. And when I thought of a topic, though, I thought, this is pretty unreasonable. And the topic is, well, it's actually an argument, and that is that imagery is a language. And it's a language just as poetic, it has just as much information. It can be specific, it can be vague, it can be stupid, but it is a language. And it's a language that we all know instinctively. We can all instinctively read it, but we don't always get a chance to speak visually. And even though I've been in the business for a long time, as you'll see, I'm constantly surprised and I'm constantly learning something. And what my point is in this talk is that images matter. If you're creating a product, if you're making an advertisement, if you're working on your Facebook page, if you're doing a painting, if you're making a film, each image matters because it's telling a story. And the man that I apprenticed under, every time I'd be doing a drawing, he would say, how do you show this? What does good look like? What does evil look like? What does happiness look like, sadness? And there's so many different answers. And some of the answers can actually be cliche, but there can be some truth in that. So my argument is that imagery is a language that we need to learn about. And I'm going to show you that by showing you an old television commercial about a lamp. Not this lamp, but this lamp. I'm afraid there's sound. After you can tell that there's a lot of storytelling going on there. There's a little bit of dialogue at the end. But in order to think about this as a language, let's look at this. So a shot, which is what a film is made up of many of them, just think of a shot as like a sentence. A shot is, technically, it's a length of film unbroken by a cut. So we begin with the lamp. For the sake of argument, let's just call the lamp me. So I'm red, I'm turned on, I live in a nice, comfortable house. This is my girlfriend or my wife, you can tell that because I'm red, she's wearing a warm colored shirt. We can see outside the window, it's cool blue. Now, that's by no accident. Actually, John Cassavetes would always do that with windows. He would put like a plastic screen colored, tinted different colors. So this one's tinted blue to make it feel cold. I'm being taken away, almost like a child. I'm looking back at my home, my life. And you can tell in this shot, it's handheld, which makes it feel kind of jumpy. It makes it feel a little bit unnerving, almost like a photojournalist. We cut to outside. My girlfriend is wearing a heavy jacket, it's cold. The tinting of the whole look is blue. The ground is wet. That's by no accident. I get dropped amongst the garbage and the leaves. I look back at where she's going at our home, and you can tell now the windows are tinted yellow, warmth, home. And you can see the wind is making me shake as if I'm cold and afraid. Now things are really bad now. It's raining, it's night. The light goes on in the inside of my lamp. Who's that guy? And the camera pushes in and pushes out between the two different worlds. The light goes out. She gives a little caress to the new lamp. And we see now that I'm looking down on the ground. Things couldn't get worse. And then we have the Greek chorus come tell us what has gone on in the commercial. So you can tell all those were storytelling. All of those were visual cues. And that's why I like looking at things over and over again, because you can kind of, if you get affected by something, you can see all the little things that instinctually that we look at that all of a sudden we understand is a way to tell a story. I'm next going to show you a clip from a movie that changed my life. I'm embarrassed to say when I was 10 years old. But I was talking to a director friend at work who was saying that this kind of is one of the best openings to a film to show you what the film is about, where we are, who the good guys are, who the bad guys are, what they're up against. It's hard to believe that that was 40 years ago. I was 10 years old. And that movie, Star Wars, changed my life. And it is, think about it, we see a ship going by, we see space, we know where this is, it's a science fiction movie. And then we see this ship that just goes on forever. And it's this big arrow, this big pointy knife-shaped shape pointing at what we would assume would be the good guys, because they're the underdogs. Now, all of this could have been done with words in a script. I mean, think about it. You could have just been inside the ship. You could have had the captain just look at the camera and say, OMG, that's a really big ship chasing after us. I hope they don't hit us. But you can see that visually, telling the story visually, is so much more effective. It affects us in an instinctual way. Again, I'm embarrassed. This movie changed my life. This is me on the right. I was always into art. I guarantee you that my painting is better than the other kids. I mean, you can see, I don't know, he's into symbolism, primitive symbolism, I would say. I was more of a social realist, post-impressionist, with the love of the pre-Raphaelites, but that would come later. Actually, what I really loved as a little kid was anything to do with space. We were still going to the moon back then. I remember being in the back of my father's pickup truck with a tripod and binoculars looking at the moon, thinking, there's somebody up there. And so anything that had to do with space, I gobbled up. Especially my drug of choice was Star Trek. It was on every day at 6 p.m. on KTVU in San Francisco. I love this crew, and this is me at my birthday with my Captain Kirk doll, but my favorite character was Mr. Spock. That's me for Halloween in my costume. This is actually picture day at my high school in 1977, and look at what I am wearing. I am wearing the blueprints and the designs from Star Trek. When Star Wars came, it was a whole different level. It was like a whole world that had been created. And when I think about it later, it was a whole world that was designed. My mother would buy the art of books for me because I was so into it. And that's where I learned that there were people, there were human beings that created these movies. And this is Ralph McQuarrie, a real sweetheart, really nice man who passed away a little while ago. But he was a god to me. And I later kind of went out of my Star Wars phase. I was studying art. I didn't really know what I would be doing. But I really enjoyed drawing people. And I met a man named Ian McCaig, who became my mentor. He was actually the best man at our wedding. But I became a storyboard artist. And a storyboard is almost like a comic book for the director. And my first job that Ian helped me get was actually for my hero, George Lucas. There's me at Skywalker Ranch. There's George. My other hero as a kid was Steve Jobs. My dad was a repairman for Xerox, the copy machines. And so we always had paper, I could always draw, but he was into technology. And so he bought, this is in 1978, actually the Apple II, sorry. This is the Apple II, 1978. Star Wars happened in 1977. And I love playing games, but there was also some rudimentary painting programs. And that's Steve Jobs right there. That's me at Pixar. But those rudimentary painting programs got me interested in painting on the computer in Photoshop. This would be the kind of thing that I would do for a video game. So it looks like a jigsaw puzzle, but you can see it's all the bits for a little spaceship. This is the geometry built by somebody else. But then these would be my paintings applied onto the model. Later on, I would be doing a lot of background paintings. This was for the pre-visualization crew on episode 2. And this would be my quick painting that would be painted on top of, the plate. So these would be really quick paintings, maybe done in a few hours, in a day, but they would just be very quick representations for the director so that they could budget how much the movie would cost and that they would get a feeling of what the movie was about. And what I noticed when I started painting was the storytelling that was involved in painting. So, like I said, this is kind of like a jigsaw puzzle. It's for this ship, the good guy ship. But why is it good? What is it about the design? What is it about the coloring that makes it a good ship? And to me, it's something familiar. It kind of looks like a jet. That's familiar. And when I looked at the real models that were made for the movie back in 75 and 76, the paint is chipped. What is that telling us? It's saying that they're always on the run. They don't have time to fix their ships, to paint them, to keep them up. So all these are little visual clues to tell us about story. The bad guy's ship, cool colors, weird technology, weird shapes. You don't understand it. It's not familiar. And for me to have to paint all these ships, I had a lot of time to think about what storytelling was going on. It did help me when I got to Pixar, and they found out that I used to do spaceships, so I would always be asked to do spaceships. Those last two ships were for WALL-E. I was still working on Ratatouille when I found out that
They were having some problems on WALL-E. This is all that they kind of had, just some rough geometry. The director was concerned, what's this movie going to look like? So me and a couple other artists were asked to do some what we called iconic paintings to show what WALL-E could look like. And this was a painting that I did based on this. And it was fun because I didn't really know anything about the story. I knew, I said, anybody seen WALL-E? All I knew was that it's the last robot on Earth. The Earth is full of trash. And so this was, they said, do your take on it. And so I thought, well, what if, I know it's trash, but what if it was beautiful? What if this is all WALL-E knows? Why don't I try and make it pretty? So I put it at sunset. I thought, oh, there would be paper flying in the air, garbage. Maybe it would look like snow. I remembered seeing a play of Macbeth where it was took place in Japan and they had cherry blossoms falling. And I thought, oh, this is kind of neat. That's kind of pretty. I had garbage sort of rolling up. And, you know, as I'm painting alone in the room, you kind of will get little ideas and you'll try out different things. When I showed the production designer, he said, oh, this is nice, Paul. It's easy to make something look beautiful at sunset. Yes, yes, yes. But he said, at the time I had some little pieces of garbage that were green. And he said, get rid of the green. I don't want to see any green. No green. And that weirded me out. I thought, well, what's a no green, Paul? Just no green. I thought, okay, racist. But then he told me why. He said, we don't have any green in the movie until WALL-E finds the plant. I want the audience to be starved for the color green. And it was true. And he asked me, well, don't you know that there's no clouds in the movie Chinatown? And I love the movie Chinatown, Jack Nicholson. And I look back and there's no clouds. Because the movie is all about Los Angeles in a drought. And so it wouldn't make sense if there were sort of happy, puffy clouds. I do have to show you this because this is one of the most famous lines in movie history.
It's Chinatown.
I don't know if you could hear that, but it was, he says, Jake, forget it, Jake, it's Chinatown. Which ends up
look,
in...
it's Cloud Town. That is my favorite. Oh, it's so soft.
Oh, let me try.
Hey, what's the big idea? You better fix that WALL-E or else you're in big trouble.
Hey, you're saying your husband was blown away by an elephant. Was he with anyone?
Yes, and there she is!
Hey, come back here!
Forget it, Jake. It's Cloud Town.
So there's lots of film nerds where I work. Just speaking briefly about Inside Out, it was fun. My wife and I, we live in San Francisco. The movie takes place in San Francisco, so it was neat to do the actual map paintings of San Francisco. These are some color studies that I did for the movie. This sort of shows how the new house that Riley and her parents move into is not so friendly. I did want to quickly talk about character design. I found this. This was a very interesting graph that somebody did at work where they simplified each one of the characters to their basic shapes. We're going to talk about up later, but you can see that Carl is a square, his wife Ellie is a circle, Doug is kind of like a pear shape, the bird is a triangle. When you look down, this is sort of the earliest version of Inside Out. Sadness is very huge, and if you see, there's that orange shape, and that's actually disgust. And just to sort of show you how characters and stories evolve, you can see how the character of disgust evolved. That at one point she was kind of disgusting rather than disgusted. Not really going to talk about Star Wars and how Darth Vader is a skull mixed with a samurai helmet, mixed with a Nazi helmet. We all know how Nazis go. But I wanted to talk about, there's a character named Darth Maul. I worked briefly on episode one, but my best friend, who was my best man, designed Darth Maul. who was the villain in episode one. And he told this fascinating story, which I think can sort of show how ideas evolve and just how powerful the idea of a visual image can be. So he had first been told that the bad guys were called Sith Knights, so Ian drew some knights. That didn't work out. He kind of did, this sort of looks like a homeless man. I see this person all the time in San Francisco in Golden Gate Park. This was kind of a neat idea, where it was sort of an alien head that you'd take off and then you'd find the villain. George Lucas wasn't really liking anything, and he said to Ian, just draw your worst nightmare. Your worst nightmare. Maybe that's the villain. This was Ian's worst nightmare. He said that he saw this weird childlike thing with tape-like hair. George got a little weirded out. Let me see if I can do my George Lucas imitation. He said,
Ian, can you draw your next worst nightmare?
So Ian had always been afraid of clowns. I was afraid of clowns. So he did these designs. Now, clowns can be very scary. This is actually from Inside Out. But Ian had a little epiphany when he started thinking in nature, what is almost like the opposite of camouflage? What is something that is a warning? So he started thinking about poisonous animals, things that you see and you immediately are afraid of. And that's how he came up with the design for Darth Maul. He thought, what if there were creatures whose pigment was a warning? Does anybody know where Mr. Incredible comes from? No, I didn't hear anything.
Pixar,
yes. It's a helmet. It was meant to be like Roman and ancient Greek helmets. Briefly want to talk about Incredibles, the sequel's coming up. This was a painting that I did early on in the film, when life is good. And you can tell that because the colors are juicy. It's like a comic book. As opposed to this. This is a matte painting that I did in Bob's office. You can see all the colors are sucked out. It's gray. You can see in the back and forth painting. This is what's called a set extension, for the film nerds out there. And that is based on a famous film called The Apartment with Jack Lemmon. It's also a little bit of Office Space, if anybody has seen that. But you can see that there is, you know, those horrible fluorescent lights. There's no really harsh shadows. It's this sort of gray grayness that tells a story.
Wow.
Wanted to briefly talk about...
It's beautiful.
The most beautiful.
So right after WALL-E, I did go to Paris. I was the weird guy all alone taking pictures in the most romantic city of the world. But it was interesting to see the language of Paris. They asked me, go to the top of the Arc de Triomphe at night and take some pictures. And all these things did help me in the paintings that I did of Paris. What is the language of Paris at night? We can see how dark the rooftops are, how the light is coming from the streets up, how in the far distance it almost becomes this abstract grouping of distant lights. This ended up being a touchstone image. I didn't take this. But what I think was neat was the director wanted Paris to be, this is where the main character, Remy, wanted to be all of his life. And so he loved it that the lights looked like jewels, like diamonds. And there's this wonderful gold feeling to it. Can't really see it, but those are the storyboards up above. This is sort of like a Frankenstein image by my production designer, Harley Jessup. People would sort of figure out which famous buildings in the Paris skyline needed to be there that I needed to paint in. I did a test that everybody hated. A friend of mine, Ernesto Nemesio, did a color study. And then these were the sort of the simple bits of geometry that I was given to paint on. And you can see I'm adding a lot of detail. And this is what the painting looks like in the end. I want to show you a very quick clip from Brad Bird, the director of Ratatouille. He directed Incredibles and Incredibles 2 coming out this summer. You're going to see a younger version of me who's actually looks sort of scared because I can't advance the slide. So look at the weird look on my face.
A thing that appealed to me about the shot is that you start with an icon that means Paris the world over, which is the Eiffel Tower. Right. But also within the same shot, you see the Seine. And the Seine is a river going through the middle of the city. That's a very romantic river. And it also is the site of a crucial scene to come,
which
is the point where Remy and Linguini bond.
Right.
So you have, in one shot, you have the Eiffel Tower, which means Paris to everyone. It's the quick read of Paris.
Right.
And then you have the Seine, and you have Gusteau's. And so you have Paris and Gusteau's, and then you have the site of the bond between Remy and that world.
Yeah.
And it's all being sort of set up in advance, in a way that you don't even know it's being set up, but it is being set up. Well, there you go. But you feel it, because now we know there's a river there, and we know that it's right down in the middle of the city, and we don't rub the audience's face in it. We just kind of cruise over it.
Right.
Sorry, that's an awkward pause. But I want to show you that scene. Brad was talking about, anybody seen Ratatouille? Oh, good. What's neat is Remy, the rat, is running within the walls, and then he comes out, and then all of a sudden, the expanse of Paris is just, it's a really cool shot. And I just want to say, I mean, I'm talking about film, but my wife and I were at Frank Lloyd Wright's home, and he's got this hallway that's extra skinny that makes you feel kind of confined, and then it opens up into this wonderful room. But it's being confined that kind of makes that next room feel so much bigger. So visual stuff is not just about film, it's about anything that you create. Oop.
Underneath Paris? Wow. It's beautiful.
The most beautiful.
This was one of the last shots that I did for Wally. I mean, for Ratatouille, sorry. And Brad was telling me this interesting thing that sunsets and sunrises usually mean the beginning or the ending of something. And so at the end of Ratatouille, Remy has started a new restaurant, a new venture. And so this new chapter of his life has begun. This is one of the few matte paintings that I've done that I really liked. But one of the things that I did that even Brad didn't know about was I tried to make these really high cirrus clouds, these golden clouds, look like a nice smell that Remy is smelling. So Brad liked that. I'm going to finish up pretty soon. How are we doing? We're doing okay. Just some quick things about Up. This is a concept painting done by me and Harley Jessup. And then the final matte painting. One of the things I loved about Up, I just loved the love story. And it's my house. So this is my house in Petaluma. I had a party. The production designer had come, and he had this weird look on my face, and or his face, and he was just saying, "Dude, this is the house." And I said, "What does that mean? Is that a good thing?" And he's like, "Dude, you don't understand. This, I want this to be the house. Can we come take pictures and do research?" So I like that. Inside the house, there were all these photographs because it was a wonderful love story. Ronnie Del Carmen had done some really cool sketches. We would get these odd renders that I would turn into a photograph. Poor Carl. I got a friend who was a balloon maker to make a balloon. And I just loved all these photo albums. And the production designer actually had this collection of photos that he had, his family had taken in front of the exact same house ever since 1921. And so he was able to sort of go through each one to show what the photographic stock would look like, what is a 1935 image look like? You know, what does a 1967, actually with a Kodak Instamatic, so here. And so all those things helped us give verisimilitude to the movie and to the images. So I do want to thank you very much for your patience, and I do honestly want you to think about my argument in that images do matter. It matters what you communicate, and that, as my mentor said, you should always be asking yourself, how do I show this? So thank you again for your patience, and it was great to be here. Thank you.
You know what I thought was really interesting is that you actually think we don't know all these movies. So you're like, you know, there's a Star Wars, this guy's called Fan. Yeah, we know. You know, we know all the movies and we know all the references and all that kind of stuff. I want to ask you a couple of questions, and then we'll open to the audience to see if they have any questions for Paul. Thank you for that beautiful journey. Do you have the best job in the world?
I think you constantly have to remind yourself, I think, because we all have good days and bad days, but no, it's a wonderful job. You get to work on stories, and I mean, I've worked on some bad films in the past in my life, and that that can hurt you, hurt your soul. And so I think there have been so many good movies from Pixar that I'd never get tired of. But I think that it is a constant reminder to also, just like you're saying, think, be thinking progressively and not just resting on your laurels and always trying to find something new that you can do or more that you can do. But I think, yeah, anytime me or some of my friends are having a bad day, hopefully there's somebody around us to tell us to shut up and to realize that we're working for a good studio and that we're making good films.
You could be refugees in Kurdistan trying to start a business, right?
Yes, yes. No.
Yesterday we had lunch together, and you talked about how you worked in Pixar and then eventually worked, you were in Lucasfilm and then worked in Pixar. Are you comfortable sharing how the culturally the environments were very different?
Right. Well, I think George Lucas was, you know, he was a pioneer filmmaker, and what I think is interesting is that when you come to the Pixar campus, it feels a little bit more like a university. The buildings they almost feel like they could be classrooms, and there's a very collegiate sort of commonness to everybody in a good way. And not that Lucasfilm was Downton Abbey, but it was the most beautiful place I've ever worked at, Skywalker Ranch. But you were working for an auteur, filmmaker, and there wasn't so much give and take, but yeah.
I have a favor to ask you, Paul.
Yes.
Between you and me,
yes,
and about the 250 people in the room, can you give us some insights into Incredible 2 that nobody knows? So it's just me, you, and these, they all promise not to share anything, and even the people that are watching the live YouTube stream will not mention anything at all, okay? What can you tell us about Incredibles 2?
Well, I worked on it for 2 weeks, so I don't even know.
You lie, come on.
No, Scout's honor, but I also like working, so there's the saying, I could tell you, but then I'd have to kill myself, and I don't want that.
Okay. I think the saying is slightly different, but okay. I have a last question. That script you put up there, was that really from 1976?
No.
Okay, because it said LOL on the end, and I think, did they say that in 1976?
No, no. Okay, that was my attempt at humor.
Okay, it worked. But it is very interesting. What you're saying is, it was exactly that being said through imagery, right? Instead of someone saying, well, there's a big spaceship, so, you know, and I guess, now that I think of it, less well-done films will try and spell things out for you. A well-done film through the imagery, through the storyboarding,
right,
will tell you who the good guy is, the bad guy is, the music, and all of that comes together. So it's great.
No, and we were talking, actually we were talking yesterday about our favorite Pixar films, and when I think about it, it's I love the first half of WALL-E. That's one of my favorite things that we've done, and the opening bit of Up, none of which has any dialogue. And yet they just tell, you know, both are wonderful love stories that you don't have WALL-E saying, oh, I love you, Eve, or, you know, yeah. that it is this thing of how do I show that? And I still can't watch Up without tearing up. And I just get captivated by all the storytelling that goes on in visuals.
So you're a romantic at heart.
Definitely, definitely.
I'd like to open it up to the audience. If you have any questions, please put up your hand so the people with the mics can see you. We have a question here. Mic people? Where is this someone with a mic? Right here in the front, we have the gentleman in the suit, and then we have Rawaf on the right there, and then we'll have the young lady there. And sorry, before you speak, a rule, guys, with any conference that involves me, Yeah, people often say, I just have something very quick to say, and they rant for 10 minutes. Okay? So if you have a 10-minute rant, please try and reduce it to a quick question. Go ahead.
Thank you very much. Paul, I have a quick question. There is a famous ratio popping up in the business world these days, return on attention. And while seeing your talk today, the amazing one, I came out with return on detail. So I want to understand the equilibrium point between the return on attention and return on detail. In what sense? When do you realize that there is enough detail to attract the enough attention? And I want to drag that into our daily life as an entrepreneur. Where should we stop thinking about perfection, our job, and just put it there for the people?
Right.
Thanks.
I bet you that's the easiest question you've ever got.
No, but it's a very good one. I mean, John Lasseter would always say that no film is ever finished. It's abandoned. You know, that at a certain point, it's pencils down. You have to put this film out, because we could noodle to death. It's interesting at Pixar that they will have, I guess, sort of different goal points where they will screen the movie internally and get people's reactions of what they like, what they don't like. And we actually do screenings to the public. And it's not necessarily that we will change major things, but by showing people outside what you're working on, that you might start to begin to hear the same complaints or the same strengths. And so I think what is good sometimes is to show what you're working on to people outside to get their opinion, because I think a lot of times you'll hear the same comments, but a lot of times we're so close to the product that we might have a nagging feeling that something's not working. But I think sometimes it's maybe goals or deadlines that you have to set for yourself. I mean, the movie's going to come out. There's a date, and if you miss that date, people get laid off, and it's bad. So I think all those things, these deadlines do help us finish the movie, because you have to make decisions sometimes under pressure. And so I think all those things kind of help. And it's, as you know, too, it's not show friends, it's show business. And the movie's got to get made. I don't think I answered your question at all, did I? Or did I? A little bit?
And if I can paraphrase, yes. You know, the deadline, is important. Am I right? I
mean, oh, yes.
Because it's like also when we work on a project, if you have an open deadline, you can just keep going and going and going, you know? So
yes.
So the deadline is a good constraint, I think. Deadline, budgets, and you work within the best. We had Dr. Yarmo earlier talk about innovation coming when you have constraints.
Yes.
So budgets and deadlines, I think, are some of those constraints. But I think if you say return on detail or return on attention, I don't think that there's a formula, right? It's more a feel of people looking at it and getting feedback, and but there is no number there's no metric that is being used, if I'm not mistaken.
No, and I think some films stylistically are very different than others. Some of the films that we've done have a lot of detail, a lot of photoreal kind of look and feel. Others are very stylized. So a lot of it depends on the director and somebody with vision that can actually say, okay, pencils down, that's what I wanted. We can go on from there. So it's, yeah.
We have a question from Rawaf, the gentleman, the good-looking man in the glasses with the tie.
Thank you. So my question is, can you share experiences of how you've been inspired to enhance your creativity by a director, and how you've been demotivated accidentally or non-intentionally by the director or manager or whatever?
Right. Well, one of the things that I like is because all the directors are in-house, we're not like an effects company where
an effects company might just work on a single sequence, action sequence. We get to work on the whole film, and so the director wants the most out of you. And so on WALL-E, it was fascinating to have a director talk to you. I did all the, if you remember in the beginning of WALL-E, there's all these space scenes that are very beautiful and colorful. And the director told me, he gave me a hook. He said, these are WALL-E's dreams, that WALL-E's life is garbage and dust and dirt. But when he dreams beautiful. He dreams these beautiful things in outer space. And that was a wonderful inspirational thing for me. That, and you could tell that the director wanted to let me in on what he was thinking. Demotivation. I think the, and I won't name films.
Go on.
No. But I think sometimes if you're looking at a film and you're saying to yourself, this could be better, I wouldn't do that. That can be demotivating. Or if somebody says that they don't like something but they don't know what they want, that can be demotivating. Because I remember hearing the story about the actor Anthony Quinn. He was having a hard time with a... I'm hearing ghosts.
Trouble coming in.
It's part of the entertainment.
That Anthony Quinn, the director, was being a little frustrated with Anthony Quinn, and Anthony Quinn was just saying, look, I'm a drugstore. Anything that you want, I can do. And I think as an artist, we're trying to present lots of different options, but hopefully you want the director to be able to explain to you what they like or what they don't like. And sometimes they don't even know what they want, but you'll do something and that might inspire them a little bit to think a different way. And so it's this weird parallel thing of you trying to do exactly what you're trying to read the mind of the director, but then also trying to put a little bit of yourself and a little bit of your experiences in. I mean, even the photograph of Carl and Ellie drinking coffee, I remember taking driving lessons when I was 16 years old and being on a hill, looking down at this elderly couple at 5 a.m. having breakfast and coffee. And as I was thinking about that, I was doing the painting. So it's, again, I kind of rambled. I think I answered the first part of your question.
I think I'll be your interpreter.
Yes.
Okay? So if it's a lack of clarity or lack of communication, it can be demotivating.
Yes.
Right? And I think this, again, using the parallel business, is not just a director and an artist, but really if you have a CEO and he's not clear on what he really wants, if the mandate is not clear, as a consultant, if I get a mandate, right. an unclear mandate from client, it's difficult to go in the right direction with this.
Yes.
So yeah, absolutely.
No, because I've had times when it was just so nice just to have a production designer. They might be a little bit short with you, but they would say, okay, they move this over there, change that a little bit, and you're done. Go on to the next thing. And I like that. It's like...
Clear and direct.
Yeah.
We had a young lady put up her hand over there. This may or may not be the last question, depending on the time that we have left.
Okay, so you have a lot of experience in the creative entertainment industry, and I just wanted to ask, it's dominated mostly by the United States and like that side of the world, and I was just wondering, like, we have a lot of talented people in the Middle East, and I've only ever seen like probably one cartoon ever challenge like American, which is Masha and Medved, which is Masha and the Bear, the Russian one. Yeah. So if we wanted to do our own like industry in this field, how do you think we would go about it, or how do you think we should go about it in your experience?
Very good question.
Another easy one.
Another easy one. Well, I was just telling Sahil that when my wife and I were in China, there were people that were saying, why did you guys do Kung Fu Panda? I didn't work on Kung Fu Panda, but they're like, that's our animal. What are you doing? You're making money on our animal. And I think that the best movies at Pixar have always come from something personal. I mean, The Incredibles has a lot to do with Brad Bird talking about his family and just, as a father, do you try and be the best father you can or the best superhero, or in his case, the best director, and Pete Docter looking in the back seat of his car driving and seeing his daughter, a look on her face that he had never seen before, and just thought, what's going on inside of her head? And that was the impetus for Inside Out. I think that each country has got its own stories, and some of those translate well to other countries. I think it's just important for you to be able to tell your story, something that means something to you. And what I've found is that if you tell a story from the heart, it resonates. In film school, I would be seeing films from France and from Japan and from China that resonated, that made me feel something, even though I had nothing to do, no experience in that culture. So I think that the good thing is that maybe people can see the experience of filmmakers that make successful films and try and make their own, especially since the tools are getting cheaper and cheaper. I just paint in Photoshop. Most of the people use Maya, which is an off-the-counter product. And people are getting so tech-savvy that I think, if anything, Pixar has a lot of successes because they will spend a lot of time on one film. And you have a lot of people from experiences from Disney and other animated studios that can see how important doing a story reel is, how important it is to have an art department to come up with a look. So I think that there are things that people from other countries can maybe see what's working from Western film studios, but tell your own story. And also just see if it resonates. I used to do acting, and people would say that you may be having the most personal experience yourself, but if the audience doesn't understand it, you've kind of failed. So I have seen a lot of films in other countries not do so well because maybe they lose touch of their story. How did I do?
Yeah, very good. You're really? Doing great.
Okay.
Just to add to the young lady, last year in the Unreasonable Thinking Summit, we had Ayman Jamal, who created the first feature-length animation film out of the Middle East called Bilal. Look that up. It's a beautiful, beautiful film, worth seeing. They're watching that, so that's being now distributed in the U.S., distributed in Australia, the Far East, etc. So it's a good start. You're right, we're not there yet by any means, but the grassroots has started. Paul, we'd like to give you a small parting gift before we finish up here. Oh.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you. Oh, good. Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Small token of our appreciation.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a seat. Thank you so much.